that the Jewish months, right? We have 12 months, just like in the calendar, baptism, just like the Gregorian calendar. But the days will shift ever so slightly for 7 of those months out of the year, right? We'll impregnate them, as it were. We'll give them one extra day. That accounts for the 11-day difference between a lunar calendar and a solar calendar. So you may be wondering, why didn't we just go with one or the other, right? And we had pressure to go in both directions. The lunar calendar basically mapped what the rest of the Near East was doing, right? All Hittite, really all these peoples in sort of ancient Canaan were on a lunar calendar. It would have made sense for us to go in that direction, right? And then as we got introduced to other cultures like the Hellenists, right, and the Romans, right, there were other cultures that did a solar calendar. And so the reflection that we have of both these two communities is very interesting in our calendar, which goes to show that we were trying to figure out how do we live on our own holy time, but also coordinate with the other cultures that we're surrounded by. Which is very interesting when you think about how does the Jewish calendar have to sort of mold itself even today, and what effects there are. So one of the funny effects of this is, right, so did some of us go to public school here? Right? Nice. Public school, right? So one of the interesting things that happens in public school, especially in America, right, where we're trying to, as much as we can, acknowledge the different cultures, right? When I was growing up, any Jewish student could get off for Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, right? Because it was recognized that those were big deal holidays, right? Sukkot, you could not get off for. And Sukkot's actually an 8-day holiday, which we'll get to, right? Not today, but as we look at the holidays. Because it was too much. How could you have Jewish students taking off a week from school? Similarly with Passover. Passover is actually also an 8-day holiday. You could get off for the first two Seders, usually just the first, but maybe the second one. But you're not supposed to be working the rest of that time either. So the public schools wouldn't allow it. Then you have holidays like Shavuot, which again we'll get to all of these, that take place in the summertime, right? So the schools have no relationship to it, and the Hebrew schools have no relationship to the after-school programs because it's in the summer, you're not going. So what ends up happening is that you have a whole many, many generations, many, many Jewish kids who grew up in public school systems, such as myself, who thought that Sukkot wasn't a major holiday, right? That Passover was only 2 days long, and thought Shavuot was sort of make-believe, like, oh, they must have meant to say Shabbat, right? It's not a real holiday, because it wasn't acknowledged by the American calendar, right? Trust me, I was shocked to know, and you'll find out, obviously, that in fact, Sukkot and Shavuot are two of the most important holidays in the Jewish calendar. The three pilgrimage holidays, where they actually would go down to Jerusalem, are Passover, Sukkot, and Shavuot. Two of those three, I literally grew up, as many, many people in my age group did, thinking they were insignificant, thinking they didn't matter. So there's sort of interesting tensions that arise from trying to fit your calendar into another culture's calendar, find its relationship. But that even exists in ancient times. So the big piece to this, which I think is so effective in the essay, is that it talks about why do we bother marking time? Why is time so important? So, amongst other things, time exists on a natural frame, right? There's light, there's dark, seasons change, right? And it's something that goes on in some ways, whether we acknowledge it or not, right? I thought the piece was very good at sort of pointing that out, and that's a reality for us. But then there's another piece to it, which is that time gains meaning through our recognition of it and has the potential for the creation of meaning. That was sort of their general sort of philosophical outlook. Any thoughts on just even that paradigm? Natural order versus applying meaning and their intersections? If not, cool. Good. I always judge it by people's facial expressions. I'm like, it looks like an intense, sounds like something you want to say. Great. No, it's all good. All right, I'll talk all the time to this thing. Okay. That's not going to happen, you'll see, because we're going to get into the challenging stuff. So, with all that said, there's a natural component to time, and then there's the human construction of meaning around that time, right? And for what it's worth, Judaism has an interest in relationship to time, obviously. On one level, God sort of creates time and sets certain orders for us. For instance, the idea that there's a seventh day that we hallow out, right? That we make holy, that we make separate. There's nothing in the natural order that tells us that seven is a natural separate number, It doesn't exist in the natural order. Not particularly sevens, right? Maybe there's something. Maybe there's some organisms where, you know, it's seven cells per this kind of molecule or whatever. Maybe there is some significance to it. But in Judaism, we're pretty clear that God chooses this day. This is sort of the order that God has created, right? But at the same time, what we'll see in the rest of the Jewish tradition is that it's up to us to figure out how to mark time, the calculations. When exactly is the moon in the right spot? It has to be for a day to count. That's not God. That's not in God's hands. That's in our hands, right? It's not one of the texts that the essay presents, but there's a pretty famous story in the Talmud where, so one of our holidays is called Rosh Chodesh, right? The beginning of the new month. We mark every month, right? And the way that you know that is, so the moon obviously waxes and wanes over the course of a 28, 29, 30 day month, right? When the moon is totally invisible, right? It's called, so to speak, it's an empty moon, as it were. That's the moon's new, right? It's ready to be revealed, so to speak, over the course of the month. So when the moon hits that point where it's totally, so to speak, invisible in the sky, right? What we had in the Talmud was that you had to have two witnesses see that, visually see that. They had to light a torch from the mountaintop that they were on, and then some other guys on another mountain would light their torch, and that would go along, right? And they would have to testify, these two witnesses, right, in front of the Beit Din, in front of the religious court, saying, this is what we saw in the sky, it must be Rosh Chodesh. Right? Seems pretty simple. But then a case is brought up in the Talmud is that, what if you have a witness that testifies to something that's actually impossible, like couldn't happen, right? So the example they give is, one of the witnesses says, it's an empty moon, it's Rosh Chodesh, right? And the other one, at the same time, says, it's a full moon. You can't have those two things at the same time. It's not literally possible, right? So, what happens, the story basically explains that you have to believe whatever your witnesses tell you, even if it's not possible, even if it's not physically possible, meaning that in that particular case, Rosh Chodesh was delayed a day because they believed that this person claimed they saw a full moon. That person was right. So what's so fascinating about that is that even if we think, right, that God assigns the time, like this has got to be Rosh Chodesh, it's 29 days, we've counted 30 days, this has got to be it. What's more important, so to speak, than God's designation of the time is humans' designation of the time. This comes up also in a section of Talmud that we learned a couple weeks ago about the idea of certain laws are no longer, not certain laws, that law in general is no longer decided by God. It's decided by humans. It's a human construction with sort of divinity on the mind. So if you remember that case, what happened was the issue over an oven, a particular kind of oven, whether it was kosher or not, right? And this one rabbi, Rabbi Eliezer, says that it is. And the other rabbis say, no, it's not, you're nuts. That oven's not kosher. And he says, well, you know what? If I'm right, let that tree uproot itself randomly. And a tree uproots itself. And the rabbi said, we don't paskin halakha by an uprooted tree. That doesn't make any sense, right? And he says, well, if I'm right, let the river run backwards, right? Flow backwards from its flow, right? And the river does it. And the other rabbis are like, we don't decide halakha based off of a river. That doesn't teach you anything, right? And then the guy says, well, look, if I'm right, let the walls of the Beit Midrash, let the walls of the Beit Midrash curve in, right? And says, the walls of the Beit Midrash curved in and they didn't fall. And the rabbis are like, no one decides a matter of halakha based off of Beit Midrash walls, right? And then finally says, if I'm right, let a voice from heaven come down and confirm it, right? And so God has a voice that comes down. It's called a bakol. A voice comes down and says, yeah, Rabbi Eliezer is right. He's right. Yeah, this is the halakha. And the other rabbis have this great phrase where they say, lo b'shamayim hi. They say, the matter's not in heaven, right? We're the Beit Din. We decide Jewish law. We decide how we actually live this thing, right? Maybe. Ah, you see the key? That's probably Emily. Nice. Woo-hoo. There we go. Yes. You guys are so lucky to get keyed in. I have to, like, mess with the key. It's pretty embarrassing because I don't know how to open it. So all of that is to say, the human construction. So the essays from there move into this general categorization of the Jewish calendar. I want to go through each of sort of the broad holidays and under these three particular lenses. So the articles talk about how our holidays occur in commemoration of natural events, historical events, or theological ideas. So I think these categories are super, super useful. So let's think, for instance, so just going down what we know about Jewish holidays already, let's pick one. Your favorite Jewish holiday. anyone, any holiday.
Passover.
There we go. The man behind the screen, exactly. Right? Thank you.
Yep.
Passover, right? Hey, no problem. Welcome. Do you need copies of the essays? Mm-hmm. My pleasure. Did it? Yes, please. Also my pleasure. Yep. Perfect. Gives me joy to give out essays. Love it. This is other stuff. So, talking about Jewish holidays, the calendar, and these three lenses with which the calendar is approached. That our holidays are either a confirmation of natural events, historical events, or sort of theological ideas or principles, God, right? So now we're using as an example, Pesach, Passover, right? So from what you know already, what does Passover commemorate? What's the story of Passover? And what you've experienced at Seder, what people have told you about it.
The Exodus.
The Exodus, right? The Exodus from Egypt. Nice, right? Mm-hmm. The experience of being enslaved, the experience of being redeemed, and like rituals of telling this story, right? So Passover is an interesting example. So now that we focus on the story of the three narratives, right? A natural event, a historical event, a theological event, right? That we focus on the story of Exodus, right? Which of those three lenses does Passover fall under?
Historical.
Yeah, historical, right? So now, here's something that's going to trip this up a little bit. The holiday of Passover, right, it's called Chag HaPesach. Pesach doesn't literally mean Passover, like to Passover something. Pesach is actually an offering. It's the name of the sacrifice that we give at the holiday, right? But the weird thing, so it gets called Chag HaPesach, holiday of the sacrifice, right, that particular offering. But it also gets another name in the Bible. It's called Chag HaAviv. I'll write that one up. Maybe. There we go. Yes. Right? Oh, good. Okay. So Passover is known as, right? Chag HaPesach. And by the way, for our linguists in here, does anyone hear what chag, what Arabic word chag may be related to? It actually is related to. You ever heard of the Hajj? Okay, so the Hajj is some Hajj, right? The Hajj is when Muslims will go to Saudi Arabia, right? They'll go to the Kaaba, right? The stone that, I believe, Abraham and Ishmael built, right? It's sort of like the house of God, as it were, this holy spot. And they'll do these circular rotations. It's an act of prayer, right? Hajj in Arabic means a pilgrimage, and you go in these circles, right? It comes etymologically from the word chag here in Hebrew, because this is when we would make a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. One of the questions we don't know is that this idea of circling and worship comes across a lot of Near Eastern traditions. There's a lot of circling. Has anyone here ever been to a dervish, like in Sufi tradition? So that's another kind of way in their prayer, right? Sort of a dance that they do in these circles. And if you think Jewishly, right, which is interesting, we think of circle dances, which we do a lot, which was all across, you know, Eastern Europe. But there's some questions. Did we used to sort of do these circuits when we would pray too? That common word. So it's called Chag HaPesach, that sacrifice word. But it's also called, and probably even more so, Chag HaAviv. Means spring. So the holiday of Passover takes place in the springtime, the holiday of fertility, the time period of fertility, right, where animals are giving birth, there's new growth. And so in that sort of beautiful symbolic way, in the same way that the Jews sort of get rebirthed through the experience of Exodus and through that liberation, it sort of matches up with this natural time, this Chag HaAviv. So an amazing scholar, Yechezkel Kaufman, points out that all of our major holidays actually also have these natural components when they sort of appeared in the natural calendar. So Passover also gets to be this spring holiday. So we have a natural component, and we have this historical component. And so what we also know about Passover, sort of filling and everything, does Passover also have a theological component? What do you think? Yeah, so in what ways? So I guess that was sort of a giveaway, but why not? It's a good giveaway. Happy to give it up. What are the theological components of Passover, of a liberation narrative? I don't know. What are your thoughts?
I mean, the, what is it? Remember that you were slaves in Egypt, and so don't enslave others, like that, the ethical commandment.
Beautiful. So there's the ethical commandment, right? You were slaves in Egypt, right? Therefore, you should never enslave someone else, right? Remember that you were a slave, right? There's the ethical component for sure, definitely. So in the Passover narrative, there's sort of, this comes up in the Haggadah big time, we're sort of conflicted over who the liberator is in the Passover story. Because in some ways, who's the obvious liberator in the Passover story?
God.
So God is sort of the obvious one, right? In the sense that, like, no human can bring down 10 plagues, right? They can't make that happen, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's an impossibility, right? No human's going to manage that or whatever, maybe. They'll find different ways to do it, but right, they're not quite
mm-hmm.
in the same way. But who's the other liberator? Who's the other hero of the story?
Moses.
Moses. And Moses is really important. Really important, right? This human form, this person who is of the people and in some ways not of the people, too. He's a sort of enigmatic figure, right? But a liberating figure, a person to lead the movement, to lead them out, to help be the deliverer of the law, to take them through the desert, to inspire them with this image of a land to come to, of something to aspire to, right? So this sort of complicated relationship between these two liberators in the Passover story starts to introduce a kind of key theological component to Judaism, which is that God acts in our history in the Bible. God is active in the Jewish people's history. But humans have to meet that activity. Humans have to meet God halfway. Would the liberation have occurred without Moses? In some ways, yes. But what would that have taught the Jewish people, or even all humanity, about the human potential to liberate themselves and others? What kind of message would that have sent? So what we start to see in a holiday like Passover, and this comes up in several different of our holidays, is that God is active in our story, in our human story, but that doesn't in any way make humans any less responsible for being active in their own stories. Any thoughts, questions, reactions?
So are you saying that all the holidays can be looked at through these three lenses?
Yes. And that's the main, I believe, is the main premise of the article. I think in some ways, the one thing I a little bit disagree with is I think that they do, sometimes they try to say one is a little bit more than the other. Which is, in some ways, so we'll look at a few of them that way. But I would argue that all three of them have these valences, and that that's sort of important. I would say not even the sort of important, I'd say it's very important. Okay. So ready to go through some holidays? Should we go through the calendar cycle? Yes! Awesome. So excited. Ooh, woo. So, as we mentioned, there are about a bajillion Jewish
holidays. I can't.
You know, the
I
miserable
can't go
holidays.
Grocery shopping the day before. I have to be on top of these things.
Because you have to have a great breakfast. If you're
well,
that Jewish home that does
yeah.
not have a great breakfast, you do not get visited again. It's I've seen it happen. You gotta do it. Okay, so now some more minor holidays. So this is gonna be a, well, not minor. Let me hold back on that. They're not minor. Holiday of the Trees. Does that sound familiar to anybody?
Oh.
What? There?
Tu Bishvat.
There we go. Tu Bishvat. Beautiful. So that is gonna come right in.
Yom HaShoah, and I don't remember what it's really
nice.
Say,
oh, fun. Now we're getting some real fun stuff, right? So Yom HaShoah, Holocaust Memorial Day, or sort of the memory of the Holocaust, right? Not to be confused with the American one, right? We celebrate them at different times. There's another one that's much less known, and I don't think, I'm not sure if we're going to actually observe it, which is called Yom Yerushalayim. That commemorates the beginning of the destruction of Jerusalem historically in 69 CE. But we'll talk a little bit about that, not so much. So Yom Yerushalayim. Awesome. Any other itty-witty-bitty things we know about since we mentioned fast days?
What is Israeli Independence Day? It's
nice. Oh, there we go. Another one. Very, very good, right? And that's going to go right in here, right? Israel Independence Day, also known as Yom HaAtzma'ut. Independence. There we go. Good. Nice. And then there are just two more itty-bitty fasts that I want to throw in here. We won't spend too much time talking about them, but they're all here. There's the 10th of Tevet, right? And there's also, sort of in here, around the same time, but really should be closer to Purim, sorry, that diagram did not work so well, is what's called Ta'anit, which means a fast of Esther. So Esther's fast. Okay. So this is going to be our working calendar. All sorts of fun. Actually, sorry, let me add one more little piece in there. Between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, it's not considered a holiday, but it's just known as a period of time, known as the 10 days of repentance, right? The Aseret Yemei Tshuva. Okay. So with our working calendar, as you can imagine, right, sort of logically, the reason why it's written in this order is by the calendar cycle. Rosh Hashanah begins in Tishrei, right? And Tisha B'Av will obviously take us to the month of Av, right? The month of Elul, which is the month right before Tishrei, doesn't actually have any holidays in it, which is sort of interesting, but we make it sort of a special time as a preparatory month before Rosh Hashanah. So if you remember, so that's usually that correlates with August, roughly the month of August, right, in the American calendar. So for those of you who've been to Romamo, because Romamo doesn't have weekday service. Sometimes they do. Have you ever noticed that in the month of Elul, there's a lot of shofar blowing, mm-hmm. whether it's at Romamo or is at another synagogue, mm-hmm. right? So the month of Elul, it's one of our customs to blow shofar every day, because shofar will be a huge aspect of both Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. So it's sort of this big preparatory month. So with all that said, let's start looking just very vague, like just sort of broadly about some of these holidays, and then we'll delve obviously much more in-depthly into Shabbat, which you'll notice we specifically did not include on here. We will get to in a second. So these three lenses, the idea of a natural order, historical event, and the theological. One of the reasons why it's super important to acknowledge all three in all of these is that, in general, Judaism is balancing a very interesting, not necessarily a paradox, but something that's sort of a challenge. The Jewish people are a unique people. It's a unique faith. It's a unique history. It's a unique inheritance. So how do we have that and also be a very in-depth and very realistic part of a larger humanity? It's sort of like that classic question that gets brought up in the story of Joseph and his brothers, right? How can you be the special brother, right? The one who's more loved by the father and still be one amongst your siblings? We see that it doesn't work out so well, which I wish more commentators would point this out. But what it goes to show is that actually part of the problem is that he perhaps was favored or was perceived as being favored. And that in many ways, the love that one receives from the parent, the ultimate parent, right, God, the creator, right, our relation to that creator, in whatever way it is, or the universal force, the energy that is humanity, doesn't specify between one people and another. We actually can't really, in some ways, we can't really live with a God, a sort of creator, that would elevate one group of people over another. When we talk about our uniqueness, it can't be about gradation. It can't be about better. It can't be about weighing the scales. That paradigm actually in many ways doesn't make sense. It has to be, in some ways, and this is totally debatable, but in some ways it has to be this way, that we're all of value. We're all have unique chosen identities and chosen pathways. And that within that uniqueness and within that chosenness, we're also inextricably connected to each other. Neither the uniqueness is denied, nor an inextricable connection is denied. So the lenses for all these holidays both acknowledge our presence and our relationship to the larger humanity, and also our uniqueness. So how does that play out? So we start the holiday, the whole holiday cycle, with Rosh Hashanah, and it's the head of the year, right? Hashanah means a year, and your Rosh is your head, right? So this is the holiday that commemorates the beginning of the creation of the world, right? Which is obviously a broad principle, right? The idea that the world has an initiative moment, right? And that works for all of humanity. And then there's a specific element that comes in sort of the Jewish relationship to that. So when you're looking at the holiday liturgy of Rosh Hashanah, you'll notice that there are three sort of important sections. One section is called Zichronot, sort of remembrances, right? It's ways that you remember God's mercy as they go through major biblical narratives. Another section is known as Malchuyot, acknowledging God's kingship. And the third section is known as Shofarot, plural of shofar, right? And it's also largely about God's wonders and our obligation to praise God, right? But incumbent in the whole holiday of Rosh Hashanah is not only the creation of the world, but the creation of our specific relationship with God. So as we've been sort of discussing from the previous segment, and we sort of talked a lot about mitzvot and about Torah, about the inheritance of our tradition, a huge part of our relationship to God, what makes it specific, is our agreeing, our sort of accepting upon ourselves the weight of the mitzvot. This phrase is often called Ol Malchut Shemayim, the weight of the mitzvot, the weight of Torah, the weight of these obligations, the weight of these traditions, right? So that becomes a huge piece of Rosh Hashanah in general. So we see both of those sort of elements. With that, Yom Kippur, which follows 10 days later, we have the sort of intermittent days, also talks about us and these kind of two valences. With that level of we've accepted the Ol Mitzvot, right, the sort of the weight of Mitzvot commandments, all of a sudden we're asked to really look into our actions. On the one hand, in a general sense, right, that how we treat all people, right, we're supposed to look at, really look at our actions, right? Sometimes it's translated as sin, but we'll look at that much more closely in a few weeks. Other times, it's just missteps, things that we don't quite nail at one given time, right? So that's about general humanity. But then we're also looked at specifically, what are the ways that we haven't been there for God? What are the ways that we haven't met certain religious requirements, right? Or religious expectations? In these two cases, what I think is significant to know, and that it sort of frames like why these valences are so important, is that for Judaism, and this is, again, sort of a paradox, there's no expression of Judaism such that religious observance, the parts that feel really specific, where their ultimate aim is just simply their specific observance. I want to be really clear on that. The end game of Jewish religious life, of halachic life, of legal life, is not just the observance in itself, right? So if you're observing Yom Kippur, kehalacha, right, like fasting, that's going to get such a great thing, right, because it's so specific, right? You know, you're not eating, you're not drinking. In Judaism, you're actually not bathing. You're, like, really afflicting yourself in some ways, right? Especially if you're a New Yorker, it's a huge affliction, right? You're not showering the whole day. But it's gross out there. But all of that said is that the end game of fasting is not just about fasting. What is the end game? In your experience, and think about it, those of you who've done fast, whether it was in a Jewish context or it was another religious context, what's the end game of a fast? What are you trying to do? What's the point? In your experience?
Well, it's denying yourself something.
Right. And what's the value in denying yourself?
Purification. Sorry.
Maybe. Mm-hmm. Some sort of discomfort, though. It is some sort of suffering, or to clear your head, or to think about something else.
Well, here we get on three things, right? So there's the purification, right? Sort of like clearing out everything else. Then perhaps thinking about the suffering piece. Right? Like, is there actually some value? What does the experience of suffering or denial, what does it open up? What does it do?
The vulnerability of your fleshy existence.
It opens up vulnerability. Beautiful, yeah. Well, feeling in your flesh, right? That groan in your stomach, maybe that lightheadedness.
Mm-hmm.
So getting in touch with our own vulnerability, maybe sort of checking our egos a little bit, right? Any other associations with what does fasting do?
Time for introspective to go inward.
Nice.
So I guess the focus on your body also allows you to go inward in a spiritual or I think mental state as well.
Right. So it's a physical type of introspection and a mental. Tell me more about if I'm thinking the right person.
No,
No.
I'm good.
It's cool. But there are thinkers who think that it's the abundance of authority that makes something of value. And there are some streams in Jewish thought that believe that. But that ultimately the end game of our specific practices that make us sort of a unique people are actually supposed to make us better people. Better people, capital people, not Jews. Better people, right? But it's our specific inheritance that says, here's the way to do it, right? Our specific discipline. Okay, so going down the calendar a little bit more, Sukkot, another one that has a historical basis, right? This is actually a holiday that commemorates how we travel in the desert. Remember, what is the sort of defining, I don't know, what do you call it, like prop at Sukkot? What do we use at Sukkot? What do we... Yeah, there we go.
Yeah.
Good, we're using gestures. I'm like, see, we have great gestures in class. Exactly. We make a sukkah, right? These
mm-hmm.
huts, right? And what else do we do? What else are some other props that we use?
Lulav and an etrog.
There we go, right? A lulav and an etrog, right? Which have all sorts of symbolic meanings, right? So, fascinating about that holiday, right? Commemorating how we actually literally travel through the desert. Did we literally travel in something that looked like the Sukkot of today? Props not, would not be so convenient. Most likely something that looked a lot more like a tent. It was an interesting moment in the commentaries. They really evaluate that, and we'll look at that later. Very interesting stuff. So it has this historical component, but also, Sukkot in general is a harvest holiday. So the other Hebrew name that holiday gets is Chag HaSaf, means the ingathering. So this was a harvest holiday that was probably observed throughout Canaan's way, Fesco Kaufman notes. But says that, well, we have this historical piece that Jews traveled around the desert in these little huts. Why don't we do it? Why don't we observe it at the time when people are gathering in their harvest anyway? So we'll be out in nature, right? So it's sort of double-edged thing there, right? Moving down a little bit, all this will go into more detail when the time comes. More and more and more. But now we hit a holiday that we all know and love. And it's like whenever you want to feel like, I know a Jewish holiday, this is the one I know. This is the one that creates the big wrench in this whole system, right? What holiday is that?
Hanukkah.
Hanukkah. Hanukkah is such a thorn in the side of Jewish identity and Jewish history, right? So who knows a little bit about the Hanukkah story? What are we familiar with? What do we remember from it? The Hanukkah story, rituals, yeah. Go for it.
There's a war,
mm-hmm.
and the Maccabees, who some probably like, a little reductively call like fundamentalists essentially.
And maybe not even so reductively.
Okay.
Maybe pretty
Are fighting against those who wish to try to assimilate more into Roman culture and life.
Yep.
The Maccabees win, which is the narrative goes, a victory for Judaism, and then they go to rededicate. I don't remember how the temple comes into the story, but they go, oh, they retake the temple from the assimilationists,
yeah.
Go to rededicate the temple, have oil for one day, it lasts for eight.
Beautiful, right? We don't even need to do the Hanukkah class, right? That's the whole deal. That's the story, right? But it really creates problems for Jewish identity. Why? One, it is clearly a military victory. Do we have any other stories, any other holidays in the Jewish community that celebrate Dafka military victories?
It's really Independence Day. Could be.
So that's another thorn in the side. Excellent, right? Great point. Because Israeli Independence Day, you'll notice, doesn't exactly fit the pattern of a lot of these other holidays, which are about God's miracles,
mm-hmm.
right? Yom HaTzma'ut, Israel Independence Day, follows the pattern of Hanukkah. And something you'll notice, which is really kind of interesting, is that when you look at the liturgy, that we have a special prayer that you say for Hanukkah, right, for the miracle of Hanukkah, also for the miracle of Purim, which we'll also get to why that's sort of weird. Yom HaTzma'ut ends up imitating the liturgy that gets written for that in the late 60s, ends up imitating the liturgy that we have for those holidays. There's something kind of weird about both, all three of those holidays. In the Hanukkah story, what role does God play?
It depends if you're lighting the candles 1 to 8 or from 8 to 1.
Ah, that's really interesting. That's actually going right to the Talmud, right? Actually, it probably does depend on that, right?
Mm.
But even that addition,
yeah.
Even the idea of the Hanukkah, that whole thing, right? It's implied, right, that this miracle took place. Like, if you have, you know, a thimblet of oil in that last 8 days, okay. I guess God did that,
that's
right?
Cool.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, right. Exactly. Like David Blaine made that happen. Like, he had some oil elsewhere, right? Who knows, right? It feels like God had to take place in that, right? The story never, never makes it explicit. In many ways, Hanukkah is a story that celebrates humans getting shit done. What about Purim, for that matter? We're just skipping Tu B'Shvat for a second, right? But Purim, which celebrates the fact, right, that Queen Esther, right, Esther marries up into the royalty, or rather she's forced to marry up into the royalty by her uncle. Interesting point to think about for feminists out there. And when the king's grand vizier wants to basically launch a massive pogrom against the Jewish people, Esther uses her status to convince the king that he should spare the Jewish people and in fact should wreak this punishment, sort of grotesque, sort of carnivalesque fantasy on Haman, on this guy who wanted to annihilate the Jews. But in that holiday too, and in that story, there's no God. God's not mentioned once in the Megillah of Esther. We have another holiday that seems to commemorate human prowess. Mordechai, Esther, thinking big picture. And then you have Yom HaAtzma'ut, right? You have the establishment of the Jewish state in 1948, right? The very next day after the announcement, feels like a story, right? Seven Arab nations come to attack, and Israel manages to be victorious, right? Was God in that? Now, some people say yes, right? But the interesting thing about it is that especially in the establishment of the State of Israel, again, we'll get to that a little bit later, there's a huge faction of Jews who feel actually darker. They want to emphasize, no, God didn't step in and make this happen. We had to make this happen. So we have three holidays that actually, in many ways, take out the theological component altogether. They take out the theological component. There's no natural component, right? Except Hanukkah had a natural component added later on, right? So if you think about when does Hanukkah usually take place, right? What month? What month in the American calendar?
December,
right? And as we know from the equinoxes, right, December is the darkest month.
Mm-hmm.
So of course it made sense to have a holiday of light in the darkest month, right? But most likely, when did Hanukkah historically take place? There's a chance it took place in Kislev, but in the Book of Maccabees, we have no date, which is really rare. We apply a date to it in the Talmud, right?
Who are the Maccabees?
So who are the Maccabees? We'll have a whole class on Hanukkah. It gets really interesting, right? But they're an interesting gang because, generally speaking, they are sort of Jewish fundamentalists. Mm-hmm. Judaism in general was assimilating under sort of Assyrian influence, Greco-Assyrian influence. And the Maccabees were essentially a zealous, fundamentalist group who believed that assimilation was a problem. And maybe assimilation was a problem. The single largest issue, the thing that sort of spurs them, is that a statue of a non-Jewish god was placed in the temple. And that sort of begins this whole battle. And in fact, the first person that dies in this battle is an assimilated Jew.
Mm.
So they're an interesting group. And the whole holiday is sort of interesting. But with all that said, these are holidays that are historically based, and it's very much in the human realm. Purim has no natural element. Hanukkah Purim literally means holiday of lots, right? Hanukkah gets a natural component added on, and Hanukkah even gets a theological component added on with the advent of the miracle of lights, right? And it, especially by calling it a nes, a miracle. So a miracle is always code for God's activity. Right,
God.
But there's a big debate in the Talmud, right? Jews can argue about
mm-hmm.
anything. It's like even
mm-hmm.
lighting the freaking menorah, right? Like, okay. But we did battle out. The question was, imagine your menorah, right? You know, I guess where your shamus is on one side, right? Do you light your candles building up in number, like one, then two, then three, then four, getting closer and closer to your shamus? Or do you start the holiday with lighting all eight and then getting less and less,
mm-hmm.
right? And so Rabbi David has this really beautiful example. Like, well, one version is saying that the light, even in the darkness, we're building up towards the light. And then there's this other version where it's like, well, actually, in many ways, like, the world is pretty dark. And it gets less and less. I'll mention another teaching with that, by the way, by another Roman the Great, Rabbi Josh, right, who said that it was very interesting. He pointed out that sometimes it's actually important to recognize the ways in which we do live in darkness,
mm.
right? So in thinking about that sort of natural order, right, we can light as much as we want during the month of December, during the month of Kislev, but I think we all feel it is a dark month nonetheless, and to try to deny that in some ways maybe has some problems to it too. So you can feel free, I don't know, I should give that halachic permission, but feel free to light the menorah any way you want based off of the Talmud. But this idea, right, that we added this theological component to something that wasn't necessarily theological, we added this natural component to something that wasn't necessarily natural. So, with all that said, Purim, in some ways, you could say is less of a problem than Hanukkah. Hanukkah, you can see how we had to do all these somersaults and kind of complicated things to give it all three valences, right? Purim doesn't even bother. Purim makes it really clear. This is just a historical holiday. And in fact, in some ways, it's the most godless holiday of them all. Because what are some of the practices associated with Purim, which is sort of interesting? Excessive drinking. I mean, in your dafka, supposed to do excessive drinking, right? So the Talmud gets in there and clarifies that a little bit, but not enough, I think. But basically, you're supposed to get so drunk that you don't know the difference between the protagonist and the antagonist of the story. The other thing that's really, right, kind of amazing, the other major practice of Purim, right, is about costumes and masks, right? That you're taking on a form that's not your own. And this is a very challenging image in Judaism, classical Judaism of that period, because obviously we're very concerned about images, right? And making images of other forms. So mask making, it's a really interesting area in Jewish art history, is a question of how big were masks in Judaism? Does anyone know anything about masks in other cultures, like what they tend to represent or tend to be? I mean, it depends on which culture you're looking at. So for instance, okay, so in a lot of Japanese theater, like Japanese no theater, right? So masks, it's really powerful and really eerie if you've ever seen a Japanese no performance, are usually an emotion personified. Happy, sad, anger. They're very, very calcified. And Judaism in general with visual art is very concerned about calcifying either humanity or God in particular, right? Then you could go into, in Indian culture, Kathakali, which was a kind of dance that's actually very much about facial expression, but there's a wing of it that's very much about masks. And so their masks were all gods, but their gods were represented again in this particular emotion. It's really nice. It's sort of like the mask was a sort of controversial art form because it really calcified something. It was representative, right? And in Judaism, as we've been discussing, we're very nervous about calcifying our image of God, right? I mean, God's merciful, but God also drowns the Egyptians in the sea. Are they the same God? Right? God changes. So the idea that we took on masks and costumes in many ways as a practice for Purim shows that we're really moving out of the theological realm in some ways with this holiday. We don't ever really resolve that problem. The final leg of this, of course, Yom HaAtzmaut, which we sort of already discussed, models these two holidays in many ways to really ask ourselves, as a Jewish people, obviously our God is important, but equally important is our connection as a community, as a people, the sort of peoplehood of Jewishness, which in some ways is very meaningful and very deep. In other ways, it also can bring in some problems, especially when we think about, if we're such a people, we're a people, what does it mean about how we relate to people who are converted, right? How do we make sure that people who convert are and feel part of a people, right? So, lots of interesting questions and things, all sorts of weird stuff. Thoughts, questions, comments, concerns?
Has the celebration on Purim changed over time, become more about costumes and masks? Did it originally start that way?
So as far as we know, it's been a really old custom because we actually have old masks. We have I forget what you call them. Oh my God, what's wrong with me?
The noise makers.
Yeah, groggers. Thank you. We actually have groggers from the 1400s and 1500s, and they have these sort of I call them frightening, but they're not sort of these picaresque, carnivalesque images actually depicted on them. So I'm not. Let me look into that a little bit more. Because I've heard about that masks are fairly old, and that the groggers are old. I'm not sure about the costumes, the dresses.
When did Purim become a holiday?
So Purim's old. So Purim is definitely biblical-based, right? For sure Tanakh-based, right? how long it was observed, we have a whole section of Talmud about it. So Masechet Megillah, right, which is the name of the scroll that we use. So it's definitely observed in some fashion as old as the Second Temple, right? Mm. But how exactly? We do know that the drunkenness, by the way, that's an old halakha. That also is from Masechet Megillah, right? So we at least know that practice is really, really old. We only get narratives that sort of begin to limit that practice in like the early medieval period, where all of a sudden they're like, well, Jews are getting a little too drunk during all this, right?
Curiosity, how do Orthodox folks deal with drinking age on Purim?
Fascinating. Huh. How do you deal with drinking age on Purim?
Or I guess like maybe halachic in general, like...
Mm. Like around this holiday, like the sort of raucousness
right.
of the holiday.
Right.
So in Orthodox, not in all, not to speak of all Orthodox communities, because one can't, as a way you can't speak of any all renewal communities or all reform communities, sort of, et cetera. Orthodox communities, in my experience, take Purim really seriously. Like, they really get dolled up, they really, really drink, it's really, really raucous, as far as I don't even know if a drinking age is observed, but in as much as, like, by American law, like, we watch out, make sure that that doesn't happen. But one of the really fascinating areas of halakha around kosherment with Purim, which is deeply fascinating, on Purim, oh, sorry, in traditional Jewish law, it is actually forbidden for a man to dress in woman's clothing and a woman to dress in man's clothing. Right? When I say traditional, I mean to say that this is like an old inherited halakha, and obviously Jews of all different stripes have responded to that in different ways and reinterpreted, right? But that's sort of a law that was inherited. The only time that that is suspended is on Purim. Dafka, it's spelled out that you are allowed, a man is allowed to dress in woman's clothing and a woman is allowed to dress in man's clothing on Purim. So I've seen a lot of Orthodox Jews in drag in my time, I will say. Williamsburg, it's always great. You know, bearded ladies is all over the place. It's great. It's great.
as a minority and a persecuted minority for many of its history, separated by geography,
yeah.
How has the following of these holidays been uniform? And how has it taken different dimensions, say in the Soviet Union, when Jews are expelled to specific sites all the way in the Far East, completely isolated, different parts in Spain and Italy. How does that transform, and how do you sort of get these different aspects of celebrating these holidays? Where does it break away?
That's a phenomenal question. So I know about certain holidays, but not all. So it is the ones that I know about. So Shabbos is actually the biggest example, which we'll transition to in a moment. So Shabbat has many specific laws about its observance, and really in order to protect the concept of not working on Shabbos, right? However, because of persecution, Jews have had to observe Shabbat in very, very different ways throughout history, right? So for instance, like we were talking about, like, you know, in the Pale of Settlement and, you know, the former USSR and these areas where Jews, you know, it often happened like you're sent to a labor camp, right? And you're at a labor camp, there is no not labor. There is no Shabbos. What do, right? So the specific case was based off of what became a practice for Jews who were exiled to Siberia, but actually came up in the camps, actually came up in during the Holocaust. There's an amazing tshuva, unfortunately I can't remember the name of the rabbi at the moment who wrote it, but was asked, like, I'm in a labor camp, how do I observe Shabbos? It's not possible. What do, right? And it's a very meaningful thing, is that what the rabbi wrote back was that the most important thing about Shabbos, right, the commandment, the first commandment, which is in the essay, right, is that you're supposed to remember the Sabbath day. It's the first thing. Zachor Yom HaShabbat, right? So this rabbi told him, you have to keep a calendar. Mark off the seventh day, whatever you can find, whatever implement you can, and mark it with these, you know what I mean? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever those are called.
Tallies.
So, say it again?
Tallies.
Tallies, thank you. You mark it with tallies. And what was remarkable is that, not in a lot, but in some of the camps, when they were, you know, people can visit them now, you see these tally marks right in their barracks. So, but apparently, so the theory behind this, a lot has been written about this particular tshuva. The theory is that it came from a practice that was actually already done by Jews who were in areas where they couldn't technically keep Shabbos because of persecution. So that's sort of a famous example. Another example that comes up is actually with Passover. So again, when we get the unit on Passover, you'll see that Passover in many ways is the hardest, most complicated Jewish holiday to observe because of our very, very strict rules around chametz, right, around anything with leaven in it, how specific it has, blah, blah. So, again, this was a practice that was done in Spain, and Dr. Stephanie Sigmund was telling us about this in class. Great, amazing medieval history, Jewish history scholar. Everyone should study with her. She's incredible. But was telling us that we have lots of cases where tshuva were written when a Jew could not literally get rid of their chametz. There's a practice actually to sell to the non-Jews in your community. That's the way you get rid of it. But that when Jews would do things like that, that would sort of spawn basically anti-Jewish feelings and would actually endanger the whole Jewish community. So there were practices that were said that they were developed and that even in some ways are developed even today, where you can have, basically, you can sell it sort of abstractly to the synagogue, and the synagogue sort of puts it away for you, and then you get it, bless you, and then you can get it back afterwards because that was a safer practice. Another one, actually, this was in Italy, was a big deal, was that, so because Passover and Easter often sort of, not conflict, but are around the same time period, right? There was a big trend in 13th, 14th, and 15th century Italy, Spain, most of Christian Europe, but specifically Italy and Spain, about this idea that Jews would desecrate the host. Has anyone ever heard about this? Like, so the host is, right, the wafer that gets through, oh my God, not transmigration, that's not the word I mean.
Transubstantiation.
Thank you. Transubstantiation, right. Through transubstantiation becomes the body of Christ, right, the body of Jesus, right? So there was a whole lore during this period that Jews were actually secretly stealing the host and, like, stabbing it. And we actually see it in Christian art from this period. It's sort of remarkable. There are these pictures of Jews with bloody hosts because the idea that this miracle happens, right, that the Jew stabs the wafer and all of a sudden Jesus' blood pours out, right? So why is this significant? Because when the holidays would conflict with each other, right, Jews would be making their matzah, right? And they would be suspected around this time period that it wasn't just matzah that they were making, that they'd actually
stolen the host to make their matzah.
Exactly.
Whoa.
Right? So there was this whole thing, basically, because we're so concerned about chametz, usually we don't make matzah up until the latest moment possible, because you don't want it to get, contaminated by anything, right? So one of the practices used to be at that time that, you know what, you can actually make your matzah much earlier, much, much earlier, so basically it won't be on the authority's mind that you might be doing this practice. So that's an example. And then actually, I feel like I was just bashing it. It's a wonderful holiday, not bashing it. Hanukkah, yeah, right? So Hanukkah is actually another example where historically, one of the major mitzvahs of Hanukkah, the sort of commands, is that your Hanukkiah, your menorah, is supposed to be in the window, daka, so people can see it. You're supposed to publicize the miracle, which also confirms this whole, we need a theological layer, right? We really want to emphasize it, right? But during periods of oppression, it wasn't safe to. So it became common practice that you could have it on the table. So those are the main examples I know of, but I'm sure there are others. That's a great question for Rabbi David. Rabbi David, answer their questions. Answer everyone's questions. Answer my questions. Everyone answer the questions. Okay, so going down a little bit more on the calendar. So we did a lot on Passover. I'm going to skip it for the time being so we can just round up with some of these other holidays. Shavuot, right? So this is the holiday, another one that has an agricultural component. It was called Chag HaKatzir, right? This is when we're basically reaping in the first fruits. Katzir literally means to cut, right? But this also becomes the Jewish narrative of when we receive the Torah, right? Matan Torah. So some of you guys may have had experience where you learn all night long. Does that sound like something you've done? A holiday in the summertime, learning all into the night, right? Ramu does a big atashi called a tikkun leil, right? But they do an all-night study, and it's supposed to reflect this experience of revelation, right? The Torah is being revealed to you. You can't sleep. You're so excited about it, right? Though about 4 in the morning, we're all like, okay, time to go home. I get it. Torah's great. Happy to do it, you know? But so this, is again one of those examples where we have a natural phenomenon that we applied our narrative to, and then of course this really interesting theological component, right, which is sort of a reflection on the two, the Chag HaKatzir, the idea of when you're reaping your first fruits, right? This is the beginning of something that you're going eventually to harvest, right? You're going to harvest it at Sukkot, right? Sort of your very beginnings. It's the fruit. It's literally actually also called Chag HaBikurim, the holiday of the first fruits, right? Well, so the theological component is very fascinating, right? Is that the giving of Torah, while this amazing moment, is really just the beginning. to the very beginning. Because I think what we see now is that what Judaism becomes is what the rabbis make of it, through Talmud, through Midrash, through philosophy, through music, through art, right? That's, in some ways, that's the Judaism that we're living. The Judaism of the Torah itself, that's sort of the beginning. Those are, that's what we grow from. But the Judaism we live now looks very different than what the Torah itself may have outlined. Okay. Thoughts, questions? Reactions? It's okay. That nice quiet feel.
Mm-hmm.
I'll touch on Tisha B'Av just for 1 second. Tisha B'Av is also a holiday that originally had just a historical component, right? It was just about these sort of terrors that befall the Jewish people, these sort of different disasters. But then we added a theological component, which is fascinating, which is that the terrible things that befall the Jewish people happen because God allows them to. And they have to do with the fact that Jews miss the mark historically, right? Whether it's ritual law or whether it's how they treat other people. The good thing is that the prophets really emphasize it's because of the way we treat other people. The hard part, sometimes that theology gets co-opted and it becomes about, well, the Jews weren't observing Shabbos. That's why X, Y, and Z happened. Which is obviously a very difficult theology, right? But all that says that, so you see those two valences. Tisha B'Av actually lacks the natural valence as much, which is sort of interesting. Okay. A lot more that we can get into. I'm going to say that for when we really delve into each of the holidays, we'll get its own time period. But for today, the holiday that really gets its fun attention, right, is Shabbat. Shabbat, Shabbat, Shabbat. So why doesn't Shabbat, so to speak, get on that list? Because of something that may be surprising. If you had to guess, what's the most important Jewish holiday? The holiday that...
Shabbat.
Right. It's Shabbat.
Yeah.
Now, would you have actually guessed that? Or is it because of my not-so-clever Lita? Here, like, it's not. It's your not-so-clever Lita. Right? Shabbat trumps any other holiday. It's more important than any other holiday. It has more rules than any other holiday, more rituals associated with it. It is by far and away the most important holiday. And the irony is that unlike any of these holidays, which only happen once a year, Shabbat happens every week,
mm-hmm.
which might lead you to think that's not that big a deal, right? Something that happens every week, like, who cares, right? It's sort of like the difference between a movie and a TV show. You know what I mean? Like, oh, okay. I mean, I don't know. A lot of TV shows are great now. But, like, it doesn't feel like it's as big a deal. Shabbat is a big deal. Shabbat is the basis of everything else. So from the article, what do people remember sort of, what are the two aspects of Shabbat, the two sort of primary reasons we observe Shabbat at all? I'll ask it another way. What does Shabbat commemorate? That's the first piece. What does Shabbat commemorate?
Creation of the world.
Creation of the world, right? So that's the universal component, right? That's sort of, so to speak, our natural component, and yet it's not of nature, right? It becomes our tradition. Our tradition has it, adds it in, right? So it has the creation of the world. And then it has one other narrative that gets associated with it. You're supposed to observe Shabbat because you were freed from Egypt. Mm, right?
Mm.
That's my... You know when you're doing something good when the cameraman's like, right? Yeah.
Mm.
Go figure, right? Shabbat is the universal creation, and it's also a particular creation of a Jewish narrative. In many ways, and I heard this at Jerusha, spoken by Rabbi David Silver, it's an amazing quote, where he said that in Shabbat, in many ways, the observance of Shabbat, the idea of Shabbat, is a litmus test for the rest of Jewish observance, because it preserves this key idea that we cannot ever lose. We are part of the universal humanity of all creation, of everything that lives and breathes, and even that doesn't live or breathe, but is. We're part of that, and we're obligated to that, and connected to that, and dependent on that, and that's dependent on us too. And we have a unique Jewish story that offers a specific spark to existence that cannot be replaced by anything else. Both of these things are true at the same time, and one does not take away from the other. I think it was right. Was it Walt Whitman who said, right? The side of true genius is to hold two contradictory ideas in your mind at the same time.
Hmm.
Right?
I've heard that. Mm-hmm.
I know, maybe it wasn't Whitman, but I just quoted to somebody. Yeah. Someone said that. It was really
yeah.
smart, right? But some people might say that they're not contradictory ideas, right? And maybe they're not. And Judaism sort of battles with that. So Shabbat has this preservation of these two things. So I want to look a little bit. There are so many fascinating texts that this article brought up that are just pivotal, 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 holding thing. But if you're looking on page 16 for a moment, right? I'm just going to sort of drag us through this and have us ask you some specific questions. Is that it tells us a little bit about this recipe for Shabbat observance, right? They call it living the dream, right? This idea of the aspiration of how the world can be. There's so much, right? So it organizes sort of four principles. That you're supposed to remember the Shabbos day, that's Zachor, right? That you're supposed to shamor it, you're supposed to protect it or guard it, right? That you're supposed to make it a, you're supposed to honor it, and you're supposed to delight in it, right? So four concepts that are kind of like, they feel a little interrelated. I'm not sure exactly what the distinctions are between them. But let's see if we can flush them out a little bit more. And the article does good. So this is going to be 16, 17, 18. You'll see we're sort of dancing around. So to remember the Sabbath day, remembering the Sabbath day is focused on the idea of positive commandments. This will come up. When we talk about Jewish law, all 613 commandments, you might be happy to know that they actually only divide into four categories, all 613. They're either Bein Adam L'Chaveiro, between you and your neighbor, human commandments, human-to-human commandments, Bein Adam L'Makom, human-to-God commandments, positive commandments, like what we're talking about in a sec, things you're supposed to do, like do this, right? And negative commands, things don't do, right? So those are four nice, easy categories. So positive commandments, and these are sort of instinctual. What's a positive commandment? What's something you're supposed to do on Shabbat? So people say, oh, it's Shabbat. You should do, what should you do?
Not work.
Ah, so the thing about that, the language, right? Yeah, so resting, right? But this is a good thing. This is how you know, right? Not work.
Mm-hmm.
Not, right? N-O-T. Negative, right? So good, okay. So rest, great. Not work, a negative. Okay, we can go back and forth. What's another positive? What are you supposed to do on Shabbos? What are people telling you to do?
Be social.
Be social. Nice, right? Have a meal. Mm-hmm. Yes. Believe it or not, that's a mitzvah around Shabbos, right? Making a meal, and not just one, but three. One Friday night, one usually Saturday afternoon-ish, and one called Sudash, your third meal around dinner time. Excellent, right? So now what's more? What's more positive ones? You do this on Shabbos. One thing you have to do on Shabbos.
Light candles.
Excellent. Lighting candles. Fabulous. What's another one?
Saying the blessings.
Excellent. Saying brachot over the candles, over the wine, right? Mm-hmm. Making kiddush. That's a huge one, right? And by the way, the commandment to observe Shabbat, which comes in this article, it says, Zachor et Yom HaShabbat, remember the Sabbath day, likadsho, to keep it holy, right? The whole idea of kiddush, of sanctifying the day with a blessing, is an interpretation of that word, to sanctify, likadsho. Comes from the same root. Great. All positives. Now, what are some negatives? What are things you're not... It's Shabbos. Don't do... What?
Use electricity.
Nice. Don't use electricity, right? Which, by the way, is an interpretation of a command that comes up in here, right? To not make a fire. That's the base command. Don't make a fire of any kind. And obviously, in our day and age, we came to interpret that because we don't necessarily use fires to light our homes anymore. We interpret that to be about lights. Any kind of fire. Anything that causes electric spark became interpreted as fire. There's a lot of nuance to that, though, obviously. But with that said, what are some more don't do's?
Don't buy anything?
Excellent. Don't engage in any commerce.
Exchange of money.
Excellent. Exchange of money. Great. That's a big one. Really, really big one. Good. This is like sort of my fantasy. I'm like, wow, I feel like we really ever get to talk about don't do's around here, but this is good. Yeah. Don't do.
Mm-hmm.
What are some other don't do's that you know of in relation to Shabbat?
Don't carry anything.
Nice. We're getting technical, right? Don't carry, right? You're not supposed to carry a burden. Now, we get a very, very complicated series of laws in the Talmud where we set up. Has anyone seen areas where they have that string sort of set up in the air?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's called an Eruv, right? It's a zone that's been designated that you can carry within this zone. It's an exceptionally complicated area of Jewish law. Definitely for the 101, the 201 course.
Mm-hmm.
For me, too. It's really hard.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. Carrying. Any other ones? Sort of related to carrying. It's a big one, actually, that is a huge part of the renewal movement. It's a huge part of the conservative movement, certainly where I'm being ordained. I'm not supposed to drive. But it comes from an original idea.
Right.
You're not supposed to ride. Right? The concern over riding was that you might break something along the way, like a twig, a branch in the ground, or the wheels of your carriage driving down, because then, if something breaks, in general, right, what are you tempted to do when something breaks?
Fix it. Work.
Exactly. No fixing. All of these sort of don't do's, right, negative commands, come under a general kind of category, which in Hebrew is called, and actually we're just reviewing this, believe it or not, in rabbi school today, which is always fun. Malechet. Machshava. Which in the article they translate it really well. Intentional or creative action. So why is this so important? So we acknowledged before that Shabbat commemorates God's creation of the world, right? But Shabbat itself, the literal day, right, the seventh day, according to the narrative that we know, what does God do on the seventh day?
Rest.
God rests, right? God just is. God spends 6 days being a creative force, and the seventh day, existing in that creation. So part of our Shabbos observance is this idea that we imitate God by being creative forces, by being partners with God in the 6 days. And on the seventh day, we try to exist. There's a great saying that actually came out of the Ziegler school, and I forget unfortunately which rabbi said that on six days of the week, we are humans doing, right? On Shabbat, you get to be human being.
Hmm.
So with the no writing and no instruments content.
Excellent, right? So I want to say a little more on that?
I'm a little confused though,
yeah.
Because if you're saying prayers and you're using your voice, that is that can be considered creating. So I don't understand that.
Right, so how do we resolve that?
Yeah.
So this is like a classic halakhic question. This is exactly the kind of thinking, right? So the writing piece, right? The writing piece is actually, which one of our texts actually brought in all the quote-unquote forbidden labors. Let me just see for a sec.
Didn't you say, like, if it's work for you?
It's not in the text, I don't think.
It's not in that text?
It's quoted earlier on.
Oh, it's
on
quoted in the other article?
It's quoted in the Shema article.
Primary category support on page 18.
Oh, here it is. Yeah, you know what? It's on page 18. So with that, right, so the writing is considered a classic labor, right? What do you smell like? A writing with an intention, right? And the music instruments piece is a really fascinating one because the ban, this quote-unquote, the traditional ban on music instruments, which, by the way, is not clear, is not at all crystal clear that there was ever a ban, or that the ban is sort of meant to hold, because for what it's worth, in the time of the temple, we all play musical instruments. That was the common practice. That was how we worshipped, right? But the issue that came up, right, is this similar with writing. When you're a musician, right, you know, you're playing guitar, you know, in your home or whatever, and a string breaks, what do you do? What do you want to do, so to speak? You want to fix it. You want to restring it, right? So that was their classic concern at the time, was that musicians, if an instrument broke, they would want to fix it. One of the amazing arguments against that, which, you know, I think we can see from the professional musicians here, I'm not sure if I've ever actually seen it happen at Rumba that a string is broken, right? Not in my experience, right? But if you are a professional instrumentalist, like a guitarist, for instance, what does Bob Dylan do at a concert when his string breaks?
Gets a new guitar.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Gets a new guitar. Any professional instrumentalist who's playing professionally knows that they need to have a backup instrument. They're not replacing a string on the spot. And if they're not replacing the string on the spot, they're also playing around it because they're professionals. Right? Oh, sorry. So there's been such a debate about the musical instruments. But now the singing piece, right? Doesn't that count as work? Aren't you sort of, is that the idea? Like you're sort of laboring to make the sound or like?
Well, I think that there's an element of creation to it,
right?
Because
the work that's done for someone else, right? So why would that make a difference, amongst other things? Like, why might it make a difference?
I read that if it's work being done on behalf for someone else, then it's not necessarily a Shabbat
activity,
but yeah, violation. If if you don't consider it work, like if you don't consider singing or painting or whatever, if it's a leisure activity for you.
You're fair. Right. Mm-hmm. If it's something that you take pleasure in,
mm-hmm.
it's not necessarily a laborious activity, right?
Mm-hmm.
It can sort of wheedle its way out of that category, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the idea of it being done for someone else is sort of the interesting thing about prayer, right? Prayer is creative. That's definitely, definitely true. And around Shabbat in general, when we do prayer, we're not exactly... It's complicated, but just mention two theories on it, which you can take or leave, right? That's how Judaism works. One is that when we're offering prayer, it's not for us. So in the 50s, we came out with a the conservative movement came out with a famous tshuva known as the drive-in tshuva, right? The drive-in tshuva, which I know we all take for granted now, but it didn't always be here. So what did it do? It noticed that Jews moving to America were in two sort of situations. They were either one, maintaining these little shtetls, essentially in the Lower East Side, which is why when it's a cool neighborhood to go to. There's a synagogue on every block.
Yeah.
It's amazing, right? But this was a poor slump. I want to emphasize that. It was a slump. Now, of course, none of us can touch it, right? It's posh and super cool. You know what I mean? Like, and trust me, I'm looking for apartments in the area. There's nothing less than $2,000 for a studio, right? It's insane. But then it was a filthy, dangerous slump. And lots of Jews were ashamed of that. The Jews who lived there were making community, doing the best they could. And actually, that's also where, by the way, the Yiddish theater really emerged in New York. So it's a very special place. But a lot of Jews, the reason why they left the Pale of Settlement, the reason why they barely escaped the camps, was to come to America to live a better life. They wanted to assimilate. So what did they want? They wanted to live in the big, sprawling suburbs where non-Jews historically had not let Jews live. But as Jews became successful in America, that's what they wanted. They wanted their white picket fence communities, and they wanted to move to the suburbs. They wanted membership in the country clubs. And this is a fairly recent experience. Right.
Yeah.
Right? You literally have that experience.
They're just hardcore assimilationists, yeah. They're not playing,
they came here for a reason.
Yeah.
This is very interesting you say that.
Yeah.
Going back to my field, the cinema, the arts, this is the central tension in the Coen Brothers' Judaism.
Mm-hmm.
This is at the core of all their films,
yeah.
when they deal with Judaism. Most of them, is that tension of this assimilation and Judaism. And it's interesting you say 1950s, because that's extremely recently.
Yeah, extremely recent, right? No, and that's so deep, because for what it's worth, that's also, I think, a large theme in Woody Allen's work, too.
Right.
Big time, right? Like
Woody Allen's the closest to touring my dad, well...
It's a very good quote, love it.
That's right.
Thought they were, I don't know, forgetful or lazy or something. That's why we weren't religious. But like, it's like a very conscious.
Oh, yeah.
I guess I have more respect for it now that I've realized that it's their like very personal conscious decision. It's not like self-effacement for them at all. It's like that's what they want.
I think that is the experience for a lot of, and certainly was the experience for a lot of Jews in America.
Yeah.
Coming here, wanting to become, and obviously we also take this for granted too, is that like, also wanting to become white folk.
Yeah.
Jews were not white when they came to this country.
Right.
And now we have to deal with something very important now, is that now that Jews have this, so to speak, quote unquote, luxury of being white, that comes with a lot of responsibilities. And all of a sudden, Jews have to really look at their own fragility in dealing with issues of race in this country, big time. Big time, right? So this assimilation thing, right, the desire to assimilate meant that Jews were moving out massively to suburbs, right? But in the suburbs, for any of us who've lived out there, spent time out there, whether you're going to a church, a mosque, or anything, it's most likely not nearby you. It's not walking distance. Some cases it is, but a lot of times it's not. So what happens is that all of a sudden these Jews who only knew from where they came from in the old country, right, that the way to get to shul was to walk there, that you weren't allowed to ride a pony, a wagon, anything, right? All of a sudden, the question comes up, well, how am I going to get to shul? So what started to happen was that Jews drove, logically. They could have an automobile just like their non-Jewish neighbor, and it was important to fit into society. So as Jews were doing this, right, rabbis, clergy, had a problem. Well, wait a minute, wait, you know, like, now you're all doing a very overt violation of the halakha. There's no way we can, how can we claim that when you're lighting a spark plug for an engine and you're traveling way out and you're probably carrying stuff on top of which, right? There's no way we can say that that's halakhically okay. But if we overtly forbid it, they're already assimilating. We're going to lose them. So in the 50s, the conservative movement came out with a tshuva that explained, that first of all, tried to, I mean, I'm talking like in the most technical sense, tried to break down how electricity works, tried to explain, like, well, it's not that much of a violation. If you think about it this way, da 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 da. And then what they really ended up hinging it on was that it is a mitzvah to pray in community, not just alone. And that's a pretty big one, right? There's definitely some evidence that that's not clear, right? And then what they really layered it on, which is why it's such an amazing piece, even though it's a legal responsa, they mentioned the sociological piece. We are going to lose Jews if we keep, right, the way we've always done it. And so they sort of resolved it. They made a sort of in-between zone by saying, well, we'll do this for the time being. Like, just for now. Because now, you know, demographics are changing. Like, it's going to, you know. But we anticipate that basically Jews will go back to halachic observance where they're walking to shul everywhere. But what happened? More and more suburban shuls got built, which is great. All well and good. They're mega shuls. They're really nice.
Mega shuls.
Right? You know? But no one walked ever again, so to speak.
And has this been a building block for other movements like feminism and Judaism?
Yes.
And other movements that also...
Feminism, LGBT ordination,
mm-hmm.
Everything, almost everything you can imagine in some ways... I'll say this is really my opinion, but that this tshuva gets looked down upon in some circles.
Yeah,
absolutely. Right?
Mm-hmm.
You can only imagine.
Yeah.
1950, it has to. Has to be.
Right.
Yeah.
You can see how problematic it was because it had to do a battle. It wanted to preserve halakha and Jewish practice, but it also saw the writing on the wall, what was happening. The problem is, it's very hard, just like you said, and sometimes even unrealistic, to have both those two at the same time. So what do you do? So one of my great teachers, Rabbi David Hoffman, said something quite brilliant today in discussing this tshuva, where he said that the way that Judaism operates is that we live in the real world, right? But we also have our eye on the aspirational. And we live in this sort of tension in between. So the reality is that some of us do not live close enough to our shuls to walk. That's a reality now, especially with gentrification. I mean, I will literally say, I cannot, in most cases, walk to my synagogue. I can walk part of the way, I can bike part of the way, but then in the middle of a blizzard, when I'm expected to teach Saturday morning, not an option. Not realistic.
You couldn't really ride the bike though, right?
So, depending on who you ask, Rabbi, I know Rabbi Ingber would support me in that, right? That you can. But some people would say that you can't, right? But even that's questionable, right? The point of that is to say is that we live in that tension in between, and what Rabbi Hoffman was proposing, which I think is really important, is that we never want to lose sight of the aspirational. So even when the reality is, and I think you're right, that it's impractical in many ways to ask our people to do certain halakhic practices, we can't necessarily do it. There is always this aspirational aspect in which we still attempt in whatever areas we can, and especially when we can make them meaningful. So the commerce one is a big one. The commerce one is huge. So just an example, I feel like I'm airing the young Tisha's dirty laundry a little bit, but I used to work for you guys, so I know you well, right? And we can all admit that this happens. We would have an amazing, you guys have been to the young Tish, right?
Mm-hmm.
Some people here, right? Or been to a meal here, right, in general?
Yes.
But the young Tish is the one that I specifically worked for. We would have an amazing meal. Torah, Kiddush, everything. Arms holding, you know what I mean? Like, we're just having a blast, and it's like, it is Shabbos all over the place, and there's Mirot, and everyone's bonding. It was the best thing ever, right? And at the end of the night, it'd be like 10:30, like clockwork, there'd be the people, oh, we're going to the bar across the street. And it was like, oh. And all of a sudden, I'd be in that moment, me and my wonderful collaborator, Jonathan Bickoff, wonderful guy, we would have that moment, oh, don't go to the bar. And we're like panicking, like, someone has an apartment around here, let's go to the apartment, let's do that, right? So this was a funny thing, right? Because in some ways, people felt like, I'm a young person in New York City, like, of course I'm going to go to the bar Friday night. Who doesn't do that, right? Or, I live in New York City. The best brunch places in the world are here. I'm not going to not go to brunch. Mm-hmm. And I remember that. I used to be a religious brunch attender. Religious. I knew every brunch place in this city. I used to know them all. now I've gotten a little rusty, right? Shabbos will ruin that for you. But, you know, but all that is to say is that even though we couldn't demand, so to speak, by any means, it wasn't realistic to say, you can't do that. God doesn't want that of you, you know? That wasn't a realistic demand. But we could work and try to create communities in which you want to stay with your community Friday night. You want to go to someone's house. You want to keep studying more Torah, right? And Saturday morning, you're thinking to yourself, you're like, you know what? I can have toast in my own apartment and then go to shul and be in community and be a human being and not a human doing.
Cold toast.
Cold toast, yeah. That, yeah. Unrealistic expectations
classic,
of people. Anyway, and I wish that was my halakhic field. There's all this stuff about like kosher toasters for Shabbat, like electronic, you know, things that like, it's really incredible. Like there's a whole industry of it. But yeah, we're always balancing, right? What's a practical ask and what is an impractical ask?
In terms of the conservative movement, this is very interesting. I if I understand correctly, remember this is a renewal community or a reform. How does it view itself?
So someone can correct me on this, but I've been told that Romo does not officially identify as renewal, but is very deeply steeped in and connected to it.
Okay.
Right.
So after
it's not affiliated.
Okay, so there we go.
Okay.
There's a number of it's part of actually the very loose net gen network.
Okay.
Which is there's a number of shuls that are redefining not by old rules but by new realities.
Okay. Ah, there we go.
So would we use the word egalitarian or?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely egalitarian.
Yeah. Yep. Mm.
And on some level non-denominational,
right?
Or trans-denominational, post-denominational.
There we go. That's like post-trans-denominational, something like that. Exactly.
Right.
All the buzzwords, love them.
Yeah.
They're so good.
In this tension between, let's say, maybe I'm mistaken in understanding this, modern Orthodox and conservative Judaism that I'm assuming probably stems a lot from these 1950s divisions, has that stunted, in lack of a better word, the conservative movement from adopting other progressive, again, lack of a better word, initiatives, therefore reframing them as either reform or renewal or egalitarian? I mean, how much of that break with modern Orthodox has identified the conservative movement today?
It's a huge question, and I think everyone understands the scope of it.
Yeah, and actually, I think
please.
The way to really think about it is, it was Orthodox, then reform.
Okay.
Right.
And then conservative filled the gap between reform and Orthodox, really.
Okay.
Yes, exactly.
And yeah, it's a tough spot.
And where would modern Orthodox form that?
And then modern Orthodox, in some ways, is a very, very recent
between
phenomenon.
That's an Orthodox creep, sort of. It's Orthodox saying we're a little bit more modern, but not so much.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And it's sort of an invention of the last 20 years. And they've done some amazing work, like Shiva Chovevei Torah Maharat, which is the first Orthodox body that's ordaining women. Like, they've done some amazing stuff.
Mm-hmm.
The question that you're bringing up about, just to reframe it, I think the same thing, is that, like, has the fact that this tshuva that we passed in the 50s, which really defined, I mean, people thought, like, when people said conservative Jew, they said driving tshuva. It was the same thing. It was like, you can drive.
Yeah,
it was, like, one and the same, right? Yeah. And did that in some ways because of the sort of mixed reaction to that tshuva, has that in some ways made us more wary to pass, so to speak, other legal precedents and other laws, right? Because we don't want to seem either too reform or too orthodox, right? Or really, but really even more so like too reform. Am I understanding that right?
No, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, thought on that and we'll reflect. Yeah.
Well, I wanted to ask just like, actually, I don't really have a question, just comment on Reconstructionism in the...
Nice. Which is also in the mix of all this, right?
Yeah.
Exactly. Beautiful.
No, I was
asking
you.
Oh, I was totally ready to sit back. I'm like, tell me about Reconstructionism.
No.
Just flip the camera that way.
Reconstructionism.
I was so excited to get off the hook on that one because we left that. Because something about Reconstructionism, which is super important in all of this, super, super important, is that when they look at the holidays, this valence thing, I mean, we're looking at a conservative movement curriculum, right? Which is what I've been asked to do by the rabbis here, and is actually, in some ways, very close, actually, what happens here at Ramu in a lot of different ways. In some ways not, but in a lot of ways, yes. But one of the major things in Reconstruction is that Reconstruction will look at the holidays, it will definitely acknowledge the natural component, right? That this comes with sort of like natural history, right? Or sort of natural development, the way the world works. They'll acknowledge the historical component. Reconstructionist Judaism will have a lot of issue with the theological component. Not to say that they'll erase it entirely, not at all. But classic Reconstructionist thinkers will have issue with applying certain theological understandings of the holidays altogether. And in terms of halakha, they're going to have a really interesting reaction to it, which when we do our sort of our halakha unit is a whole other unit in and of itself, right? There's a big question about halakha. Is halakha ordained by God? Or is halakha ordained by humans? Or is there a weird conflation of the two? Do they sort of get mixed together? This is a huge question, especially for those of us who are experienced with Catholicism at all, right? Does the law come from the Pope, right? Who is a human? But is this human a manifestation of God? Is the halakha, as we think of it, a manifestation of God? Does that make it unquestionable, unchangeable? Does that make it inflexible? To what degree can it be flexible? Are we playing? Are we becoming? Do we have too much hubris if we think we can change the halakha? Or are we spineless if we think that we can't? Right? I mean, these are the real issues, right? I mean, very much so. So with this issue specifically in the conservative movement about that tshuva, what it has caused in many ways is two sort of breakoffs. In one way, I wish the people I'm immediately working with, my colleagues, would actually give more credit to the driving tshuva this way. I think the driving tshuva in truth did open the door for many important laws, especially in the reform, reconstructionist, renewal world. I think so. Very few people will ever cite that or make that claim, but I think it's true. Because the thing that makes the driving tshuva so important is that in some ways it's a legal tshuva. It used legal principles like from these labors, you know, this trying to figure out ways. Because driving isn't such a big deal, right? But really, it was a sociological piece. Mm-hmm. It commented on the realities of Jews, right? So even when we had to address things like women's ordination, for instance, right, egalitarianism of women, our texts make it pretty darn clear that women were not considered equal to men.
And I'm sorry, right? how far along did that happen? Like, how
women's ordination of the conservative movement only occurred in 1984.
Okay.
So we're just over 30, right?
What time is it?
I'm sorry, I know, right?
No, I'm saying, like, how recent was it?
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
It feels like it was just yesterday, right?
Yeah.
30 years ago, right? Uh-huh. The conservative movement was the last of the party.
Mm-hmm.
But the reform movement wasn't that much earlier, only a few years earlier.
Right.
The Reconstructionist world had the first known bat mitzvah, so to speak, right, in the 20s. So the conservative movement, in many ways, was the last of the party. But we could also say that modern Orthodoxy was really the last of the party because they just did it about 6 years ago, right?
Orthodox still not there yet.
Right, and the rest of the Orthodox world,
right,
not even in that conversation, right?
Personal anecdote was, I mean this for humor, but I came to Romumu, was my very first synagogue I've ever been in, and it was, I am such a hippie, it was such a, like, perfect,
right.
For me, I didn't need to, like, shop around at all,
nice.
And so then I had this such shell shock, like, as I made friends and, like, branched out into other and tried other communities, and you don't know what you don't know.
Right.
It's like, wow! Yeah.
Totally.
This is a very unique place, so it just made me, like,
like, okay, right. Was it, there's no place like home, right?
Yeah. I was like, and I chose right, yeah.
Totally.
For me, here.
No,
so
I totally hear that.
But I just mean that as comedy.
Like, no, it's very comforting. I'm glad. Rumble should be home. It is home.
I did accidentally walk into the, like, women's side of an Orthodox.
That's a really big deal.
Yeah.
Did someone tell you? What's the
catch? I knew the drill at this point, and just walked into a room that I had a thing in right after this service,
right.
Basically, and it was just, like, horrified and slammed the door.
We all have our Jew traumas,
yeah.
However
no.
they come down.
Yeah.
I want to leave us on this note because I'm being cognizant of time. We have 2 minutes left. Because
oh.
this question is so huge. And I really do, I think this is a very, very big piece about what we do with halakha at large. And I'm really glad that you brought it up now. And we'll do it in depth when we look at our halakha section, for sure. Because it has to be addressed. It's a huge issue. The thing about Shabbos and about why it's such a good example to sort of begin with and why it becomes sort of like why it's the supreme Jewish holiday, right? So we talked about this litmus test. We're part of a larger humanity and we're also particular, right? We're a particular people with a particular tradition, a particular inheritance, a particular gift to the world, right? Just like anyone else's gift, but ours is particular as well, just as theirs is, right? Like, how many different ways can I say that? Like, I'm stumbling, right?
As many as you can.
As many as I can.
Please.
Good.
There's
good.
No shortage.
Good, because it's really, because you can tell my own baggage with it. I
cannot,
I personally, Bronwyn, sorry, JTS and everybody else, cannot live with the idea of any sort of chosenness making us in any way better. We're all chosen. We're all children of God, right? But every child's different, right? But with that said, Shabbat becomes this really interesting way to start this whole conversation of what, how we relate to Jewish practice. The point of not lighting a fire on Shabbos is not about not lighting a fire, right? The point of not winnowing, you know what I mean? Striking a final blow with a hammer, right? It's not the point. There's nothing ethically, morally wrong with using a hammer because you're allowed to do it the other 6 days of the week, right? What Shabbos tries to preserve, especially both in the positive and in the negative commandments, right, what you do and what you don't do, is this idea that there is a state of being as humans that we can aspire to, right? There are humans as we are, of course, and then we can aspire, right? We wouldn't go into therapy if we didn't believe that we could get over our baggage or work through it, right? We wouldn't go to the gym if we didn't believe that the body was worth preserving. We wouldn't eat healthily that way if the body wasn't sacred in some way and deserved that, right? We wouldn't look into our dreams if we didn't think that the unconscious had something to teach us, right? So we are as we are, and then we have something to aspire to. The point, the entire point of halakha, of our practices, right? Of separating milk and meat, thinking about values of life and death, the whole point of not engaging in commerce and not making other people work for us. That's the other piece of commerce, but I just remember that. When you're going to a restaurant, you, I mean me, right, to remember, that person's working for me. That person isn't on break. That person's serving me. It's very powerful in Israel, by the way, to say, when no one's working. I mean, obviously that's not true in the whole country, but it's very powerful in Jerusalem. You can't go to a restaurant. There's not a restaurant open. Not in walking distance. But then there's no public bus. And there's no taxis operating because all those people have a day off. Whether they're going to shul or not, they're not working. You're not a servant on that day, right? So with all of that said, Shabbos is sort of this primary sort of vortex of Jewish observance in which we ask, how can I aspire to be a human being? Not doing, not getting my value or my worth that way, but by my very being. How am I like God in the image of God? So when we look at other Jewish presidents, I think next week, I wish I had the curriculum in front of me, we're gonna go just literally down our list of essays, we'll go through the holidays, how their practices preserve this sort of reality of being. What does Judaism have to teach us about a better being, the best being that we can do, right, and can be? Okay, thank you everybody.
Thank you.
What do we do here?